name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess
to my God
and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that we may celebrate with heartfelt devotion these days of joy, which we keep in honor of the risen Lord, and that what we relive in remembrance, we may always hold to in what we do. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When Peter entered, Cornelius met him and, falling at his feet, paid him homage. Peter, however, raised him up, saying, "Get up, I myself am also a human being." Then Peter proceeded to speak and said, "In truth, I see that God shows no partiality. Rather, in every nation, whoever fears him and acts uprightly is acceptable to him." While Peter was still speaking these things, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who were listening to the word. The circumcised believers who had accompanied Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit should have been poured out on the Gentiles also, for they could hear them speaking in tongues and glorifying God. Then Peter responded, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit even as we have?" He ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord. A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is of God. Everyone who loves is begotten by God and knows God. Whoever is without love does not know God, for God is love. In this way, the love of God was revealed to us. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might have life through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as expiation for our sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "As the Father loves me, so I also love you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy might be complete. This is my commandment. Love one another as I love you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I no longer call you slaves, because a slave does not know what his master is doing. I have called you friends, because I have told you everything that I have heard from my Father. It was not you who chose me, but I who chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit that will remain, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give to you. This I command you, love one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
How did Christianity spread so far, so fast, and so successfully in our first centuries. Given that Christians were bitterly opposed and often brutally persecuted by secular and religious authorities alike, how did the gospel of Jesus Christ conquer the Roman Empire? With the only weapon Christ gave us, love. But it seems impossible to the world that human affairs can be governed by love when only law will do. Every society in history has had some form of law with which to organize human life and regulate behavior, lest chaos and anarchy make our lives solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. But even though law is necessary for human life to be well ordered, law is not sufficient for human life to flourish, because the final guarantee of every legal system is coercion by force. After all, laws which are not or cannot be enforced are worse than useless, as we have discovered on the campuses of our elite universities in recent days. And so a society governed by law must use force in response to lawlessness, to see that laws are observed and that lawbreakers are punished. And that is true even in Christian societies. But in the pre-Christian world, force was often the only reality common to every human society, including too often, even within families. But as history teaches us, force cannot nurture or sustain the human spirit. Consider, before the light of the gospel filled the world, murder was too often used to settle both personal and political disputes. And unjust war for the sake of taking what belonged to someone else was all too common. And these things are still true where the light of the gospel does not yet shine. Women and children were treated as property, and sadly, too often still are. And slavery was regarded as an essential foundation of economic and political life, as in some form is still the case in too many places. Poverty and illness were widely regarded as signs of divine punishment for personal or ancestral misdeeds. And there was little or no sense of obligation to assist those in need, to protect the weak, or to see each person as having intrinsic dignity worthy of respect by all others. Then into this darksome world came the light of the world, the Lord Jesus Christ, who sent his disciples to the ends of the earth to proclaim the good news of salvation and to announce the inbreaking into human history of the kingdom of God. And at the heart of Christ's gospel is the revelation of divine love for every person. God is love, and every human person without exception is made in the image and likeness of God to share the love of God forever, in such a way that unto the ages of ages, everyone who by grace through faith is made a new creation in and by Jesus Christ will participate world without end in the divine nature of God the Son and be changed from glory into glory at a joyful wedding feast that never ends. And how do Christians teach the world this extraordinary and liberating truth about human nature and eternal destiny? Hear the Lord Jesus in the gospel today. As the Father loves me, so I also love you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love. This I command you, love one another. And that is why St. John wrote in his first letter, which we read today, whoever is without love does not know God, for God is love. In this way, the love of God was revealed to us. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might have life through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he has loved us and sent his Son as the expiation for our sins. In our second lesson and gospel today, the word love recurs 18 times. And each of those words in the Greek original is a form of agape, a term which comes into Latin as caritas, and thence into English first as charity, and then as love. This kind of love differs from three other forms of love that we all experience. Agape is different than storge, or affection, different than philia, or friendship, and different than eros, or romantic desire. Those natural loves are essential to our lives, but agape is something both higher and deeper. Agape love is unconditional and self-sacrificing, and this is the love of the Father for the Son and of the Son for the Father. Agape love in human life is not a natural occurrence. It is a gift of divine grace that is poured into us at our baptism. Although agape love is manifested in deeds of charity, it differs profoundly from natural human kindness, which even pagans practice. Only those who are born again by water and the Holy Spirit receive three supernatural gifts that cannot be learned or acquired by our own effort. These are the theological virtues of faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is agape, charity, love. The evidence of agape is found not primarily in our words, but above all in our deeds. And so the Savior says, "If you love me, keep my commandments. This is my commandment, love one another as I love you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you, and this I command you, love one another." Friends, this is how the gospel overcame the darkness of the ancient world and conquered the Roman Empire. Love. Christians lived according to the teaching of Christ, and so hearts and minds were changed. And more than that, the universal scope of the church was the first time in history that tribe, race, sex, wealth, and social position were not the sources of permanent divisions in human life. And in the church, a vision of a truly universal human nature and human dignity began to take shape and was shared with the world by the church's universal mission to the nations. We see that in the first lesson today, where we read that Simon Peter was guided by God to the home of who should have been a hated enemy, a Roman centurion named Cornelius. We read in that lesson that everyone in his home had an experience like Pentecost, which signified to Peter and all the Christians of Jewish origin that the eternal plan of salvation includes Gentile humanity. Peter said, "In truth, I see that God shows no partiality. Rather, in every nation, whoever fears him and acts uprightly is acceptable to him." And then Peter added, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit even as we have?" He ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. From the beginning of the church's life, the baptism not just of individuals, but of entire families, including infant children and household servants, was practiced as a sign of the completely gratuitous grace of God. And as lives were changed, whether one person or one family at a time, so too were whole societies changed, which then formed an entire civilization shaped by the gospel, Christendom. That is how the gospel triumphed in the Roman Empire, and how the gospel spreads in every time and place. And God's word and sacraments are always accompanied by works of charity. But while Christians tend the sick and welcome the immigrant and care for the orphan and the widow and visit the imprisoned and teach the ignorant and clothe the naked and feed the hungry, the church is not another social service or non-governmental agency like the International Red Cross or Doctors Without Borders or the UN. No, the church is the bride of Christ, brought into being from his pierced side when blood and water flowed out to the world as a fountain of divine love and sacramental life for the salvation of the entire human race. On the cross, Christ showed us the fulfillment of the law and the full measure of love. And in this way, he revealed the perfect law of love, in which there is no coercion or force, but only the total gift of self, leading to the consummation of perfect joy. And the church's mission is to invite the entire human race to receive the grace of salvation through friendship. Friendship with Jesus Christ, a friendship born of faith, hope, and love. By dying on the cross, the Lord Jesus became the expiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for those of the whole world. And by rising from the dead, Christ redeemed us from the grave and revealed the new life of grace by which we share even now in his victory over sin and death. Christ Jesus is our Passover and our peace. He is the Lamb once slain who lives forever. And the good news of salvation is that only in Jesus Christ, crucified and risen, does every human person find his true dignity and her eternal destiny in love. Friends, God be praised. Christos Anesti, Alithos Anesti. Christ is risen, truly he is risen. Alleluia, alleluia. I believe in God,
Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting, that we may always be ready to give an account of the hope that is within us. Let us ask for the grace of constant conversion through the obedience of faith.
For all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be fearless heralds of the gospel and true ministers of the sacraments, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have been baptized and sealed with sacred chrism in the sacrament of confirmation, that by the gifts of the Holy Spirit they may always bear witness to the truth of the gospel, Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the young men whom God is calling to the sacred priesthood, that they will find the courage to answer their call and be sustained by the support of those who love them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in the armed forces and emergency services who defend and protect us, that they may be preserved from all harm, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, marked with the sign of faith, that they may be gathered into the kingdom of eternal life, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Everlasting Father, you have exalted your Son with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send your Holy Spirit to strengthen us, confirm us in faith, and lift us up to that place where our Savior has gone before, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A warm welcome to all, especially to our visitors. Collection plates are available at each door of the church, and thank you for your generosity. Please note that the Solemnity of the Ascension is celebrated next Sunday rather than this Thursday. Finally, offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High.
hands up to you, O Lord, together with the sacrificial offerings, so that purified by your graciousness, we may be conformed to the mysteries of your mighty love, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. By the oblation of his body, he brought the sacrifices of all to fulfillment in the reality of the cross, and by commending himself to you for our salvation, showed himself the priest, the altar, and the lamb of sacrifice. Therefore, overflowing with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name.
Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Mysterium Fidei. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Jacques our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who restore us to eternal life in the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this Paschal Sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.